seriously, guys, I missed 40 chapters and then suddenly everybody's bankaiing all over the place? Come on! Hey guys, this is Carla, and this week I'm going to talk about something that I haven't talked about yet, and that is manga. You might have heard me say that when it comes to television, I really prefer binge watching TV shows. Mostly the idea of not having to wait and being able to just watch one after the other is really appealing to me, so that's what I like to do with television. You've heard me say this a couple times already in previous videos. What you haven't heard me say yet is that I also tend to binge read manga. I'm not that big a manga reader. I generally prefer anime just because it's easier to access. I live in freaking Narnia, so it's not like I get manga here in every corner. I usually have to buy it on Amazon or whenever I travel to some place that does have something like a Barnes & Noble or whatever, I usually buy some manga there, but I can't follow every single anime I watch in manga format. I don't have enough time and I don't have enough brain space for that. I tend to not read manga as much. However, there's a few specific series that I really enjoy that I've watched the anime and it's made me want to know more, go a little bit more in depth, so I decided to read the manga. I have a few of those. I have something like a Full Metal Alchemist or Evangelion, Attack on Titan, that sort of stuff, where the manga's not too demanding of my time, but it's very interesting to read because you get stuff that you don't see in the anime. One of those mangas for me is Bleach. And here's the thing about manga though. Usually when I'm reading manga and the plot is really up to date, I will read it as soon as possible after it's released. Sometimes it's once a month, sometimes it's weekly, it depends. When it comes to shonen manga though, because it's so focused on action, sometimes the mangaka go sort of on a detour, like, oh, let's focus on this fight now, or on that fight now, and I'm not really big into fights, so when they start getting into, like, fight after fight after fight, when it comes to characters that I don't care about, I get easily bored. When it comes to a manga like Bleach, for example, that happens all the time, and I get bored, and then I stop reading the manga. That happens a lot. So I leave the scheduled manga reading for a long time, and then all of a sudden, like half a year later, somebody will come up to me and be like, oh my god, did you see what just happened in Bleach? And I'm like, what just happened? Guess now I have to go back and read it. And then I have to go to the manga, read it, and they end up having something like over 20 chapters to make up for, which is what I call my binge reading period. That just happened to me last week. My brother came in, told me, hey, you should go back to reading Bleach. Something really awesome has happened with one of your favorite characters, so you have to go and read it. So I sat down on Sunday and I read through like 40 freaking chapters of Bleach. It was insane. It took me like 6 hours, just so you know. Because I am now up to date with Bleach, yay! This latest development sort of reinstated my love for Bleach because the anime is no longer airing anymore. It was a very Bleach-less period for me. And I had to read 40 chapters, so that's like since like maybe last year or something. It's like 10 months without Bleach in my life. This has reinstated my love for Bleach. And so I decided that this week I'm going to talk about Bleach. So because I'm lazy, I'm gonna do the whole 30-day challenge routine all over again, but there's so much to talk about in Bleach. I mean, this thing has been going on for 600 chapters already, so there's so much to talk about, and if I sat down and wrote my own outline for this video, I would never end. So I really do think that the 30-day challenge here is more self-preservation than it actually is laziness, or at least that's my story and I'm sticking to it, but that's what I'm gonna do now. So let's start! Bleach 30-day challenge done in one video. Yay for efficiency! Number one favorite character. That is and always will be Ishida. I love him. And I mean Uryu, not the father nor the grandfather, Uryu. I love him to death. Since day one, he's been my favorite character in this series. I love how much of a knight in shining armor thing he has going on. Like, he's very much about pride and very much about defending the weak and just all these lofty ideals that he has, but at the same time he's a big nerd, shy and awkward and just all over the place, and I love him to death. He's so great. I adore Isha, and I kind of didn't like that for a lot of the passage of several different arcs he didn't get enough time to shine. I mean, he shone very high in the society arc, and then he really is shining now in this whole Quincy thousand year war, whatever it's called, arc. But in the middle in there was not much of him, and I think that's a lot of the part of the reason why I stopped reading Bleach a while ago, just because I get bored when my favorite characters aren't around, and that has a lot to do with it. But I love Uryu. He's so brave, and he places very high values on himself, and he knows the worth of people. And even though he disagrees with a lot of things when it comes to Ichigo and the others, he's also a really great friend. He's doing so great in the last 40 chapters that I read. Seriously, guys, if you haven't caught up with Bleach, please do. It's awesome at the moment. And all the characters are being so great, and I'm loving it so much. But Uryu is excellent. I have been suffering through this entire Quincy arc just because this whole thing where he went off with the bad guy and left all his friends wondering whether their friendship had been a mistake or whatever, and now it turns out that I'm going to spoil you, I'm sorry.
Danger, Will Robinson! Danger! No, Will Robinson! Danger!
You should be reading this! It turns out that it was all a plan that he had from the beginning, because he thought he was the only one who could possibly defeat the bad guy, because it's a Quincy thing, so he thought he was the only one who could do it. And now it's revealed that he's really not evil, he's just trying to take down the bad guy just as much as all the other ones does. And now his friends know, and they love each other so much, and they're such great friends. I love them. Uryu, you're the best. He's so great. He's so awesome. I love him. That's all. Number two, least favorite character. There's one name that comes to mind before anyone else, and that is Kurotsuchi Mayuri. That guy's so disgusting. Ugh, awful, awful. He totally gives a bad name to all scientists everywhere. He's a disgusting person. He has experimented on Quincy's and other living beings just for his sick amusement, created Nemu to be basically a slave. The guy is awful. His ethics are awful. That man is disgusting, and seriously, like, not even his powers are all that cool. He is all about the venom, and then his bankai and his shikai and his sword, his powers, they're all kind of like having to do with embryos, and it's just disgusting. And I also don't like, and this is not so much a character, but Kubo himself, I don't like that Kubo sort of uses Mayuri to bring people back to life that you thought were dead, or not necessarily that they were dead, but you thought they were out for the count, like they were knocked out, they were ICU bound, and you wouldn't see them for a long time, and then all of a sudden here comes Mayuri with some kind of invention that boop makes them all normal, and they're back and ready for a fight. It just, I think it takes away the emotional impact of things, because you always just look to Mayuri and say, okay, what are you gonna do now to make this all better now? It's silly, because you suffer so much with these characters through their fight that you expect their pain and their suffering and their struggle and their death, if it happens, to be meaningful, and then Mayuri just takes it all away. With science. Guess what? Science doesn't work that way. Apart from Mayuri though, I do have a couple others. I hate Ivach. I don't know if I'm pronouncing this right, but they're German, so this is how the Germans would pronounce it. Ivach! Ivach, and who's the leader of the Quincy's, and Sayel, who was an Arrancar. I hated both of them. Every time Ivach comes up in the page, I'm like, oh, just die! And Sayel, if Mayuri is disgusting, then Sayel is like three times more disgusting. I hated all three of them. Number three, favorite arc. For me, it would probably be the Soul Society arc, just them dealing with the 13 squads and stuff, because it introduced so many characters that I love, and the twist at the end was amazing with Aizen, and just it's the one where the Nakama actually became Nakama, or the friends, they actually really became a unit, and I kind of love that. I do, however, really like the beginning of the Quincy Saga of the Thousand Year War arc, because we learn so much about the history of the characters. It's kind of amazing. We learn so much about Ichigo, we learn so much about Quincy, we learn that everything is connected somehow, and that blows my mind, because to even think that Kubo may have been planning all of this since day one, it's kind of mind-blowing to me, so I like that. However, later on, you know, when Eva started becoming way overpowered and crap, and all these random, like, Quincy's just started popping up, and none of them really meant anything to me. And then there were a lot of fights that didn't really mean anything. It kind of got boring for me, but the beginning I really liked. I really want to see it animated too, because I know that the anime stopped before they got to that point. But I think if they are able to condense the story a little bit more, it could be a really great arc to have animated, just for closure, really. I do have one honorable mention. This is a filler arc in the anime, so I don't really consider it one of the great ones because it wasn't written by Kubo, but I still like the Unknown Tales of the Zanpakuto, just because I like seeing the swords come to life. I like the general idea of it. Just, I love the relationships between the Shinigami and their swords, and I think it was well done for the most part. I really liked all the characters, so it gets an honorable mention, even if it's a filler. Number four, least favorite arc. That would probably be Hueco Mundo, because I didn't like the Arrancar. I didn't like what Aizen was trying to do with them, not really. I like the Aizen twist when he left Soul Society. I didn't like it when he was on his own. And he seemed like stupidly overpowered. He still seems that way, but at least now he's being held back. He's in prison or whatever. Hueco Mundo just didn't do anything for me. I didn't find the characters memorable. Coming after an arc as great as the Soul Society one, it just felt like a bit of a letdown. And that was the first part where I started getting bored and stopped reading several times over, actually. I just don't like the characters as much. I don't like the plot as much. It felt really sort of intermediate to me. So yeah, it would be Hueco Mundo for me. Also, can I just point out, please do not let Kubo ever, ever attempt to use another language for his own mangas, because he's terrible at it. The German's a little bit decent, I would say. His Spanish was terrible. His Spanish was terrible. Oh god. Cuatro Espada? No, that's just... Don't, just stick to Japanese, dude. It's... Don't butcher my language, please. It's terrible. Number five, favorite character from the 13 Court Guard Squads. That is the one and only Hitsugaya Toshiro. Yay, Shiro-chan! I love him to death. Shiro-chan would be my second favorite character. He is, he always will be. I love him to death. He is so cute and so, he thinks he's so cool. At the same time, he can be that cool. And I love him. He's a force to be reckoned with. He will always try to do the right thing, but also front like he's not really actually trying to do the right thing because he's way too cool for that. He's so cute. I love him. He's such a great character. He's serious but funny at the same time, and he's such an old soul in such a little body that is kind of ironic, but at the same time you just know that there's this wisdom to him that is fantastic, and he will give everything in order to do the right thing and save the people, and I love him. I love Shiro-chan. He's my Shiro-chan. My Shiro-chan. I love him. He is so great and I'm a huge fan of his, and so yeah, he will always be my favorite. Not that I don't have other favorites, I will touch up on that in a later question, but him and Uryu are my favorites. Absolutely. Positively, completely. Number six, favorite Zanpakuto or Shikai? For me, I have several. I'm a fan of swords, okay? I like swords. Not to use them because I'm too clumsy, I would probably end up cutting my own fingers or something, but I like seeing swords in anime and manga, and I think they're an awesome weapon, very honorable weapon, a very genuine weapon. It's like what you do with your sword is your own effort rather than, you know, guns where it's just like, and you can kill 1,000 people from really far away and they don't even have to look you in the face. With swords it feels more genuine, so I've always been drawn to the idea of the Zanpakuto, just because it's not just a weapon, it's almost like a companion, an extension of your own power, and it's a living thing. How can you make it a sword even better but to make it a living thing? So I have several. I can't choose just one. I have several depending on the context. If it came to looks, the winner would probably be Nejibana, which is Chiba Kayan's Sanpakuto, because it's a freaking trident. You guys, it's a trident. Can we talk about how cool that is? Rankle the seas and heavens. Nejibana! And then he's right there with the trident, and I'm freaking out as I'm reading that passage. I also really like the way that Shuhei's Shikai looks. Shuhei's Sanpakuto is called Katsushimi, and it's basically two-sided sights, and they're connected to each other with a chain. So not only can you use them to like slash at people, but you can also twirl them around so they start moving like fan blades and just kill everybody around you. It looks so cool because these are Grim Reapers, basically. These are Shinigami, means God of Death. Soul Reapers, right? So you would expect at least one of them to have a scythe. And I just love that indeed there's one that has a scythe. And it's not just any scythe, it's a double scythe, which is double-sided on each scythe and joined together by a chain so that you can spin it around. It's awesome. It looks amazing. If it comes to powers, on the other hand, I prefer the more psychological manipulation sort of powers. So I'm really fond of Hirako's Sakanade, which basically can completely turn your perception around, like what is in front is now in the back, and what is up is now down, and what is right is now left, and it just turns you around completely. I love that, and the way it was used for the first time in the manga is still to this day one of my favorite moments in the entire Bleach manga, and I'm gonna talk about that later, but I really, really, really just really love Sakanade and its powers. And also then there's Aizen's Kyokasuigetsu, which is basically an illusion type of power. Basically, he can convince you of anything if you haven't seen the sword. And then if you see it, you realize it. And if you touch it, then you can't fall into the illusion. But I just think it's really great. And the way Aizen used it to manipulate every freaking person in Soul Society is still mind-blowing. So yeah, those are my favorite, those four. Katsushimi, Nejibana, Sakanade, and Kyokasuigetsu for me, those four. Come on! It's my question. It's my questionnaire. I can totally just say four, even if I'm supposed to be only doing one, whatever. Number seven, favorite bankai. I'm really not a big fan of bankais. I find them overly complicated. I really like the simplicity of some of the powers that the Shinigami have. They're simple. It's like, okay, here you have this character, this is his personality, this is his element, this is going to be his power. I like simplicity. Bankais have always seemed overly complicated to me. Oh, let's take this thing and make it spin, or make it throw fire, or make it like 70,000 more times more powerful, or blah blah blah, and it gets too complicated for me. So I tend not to like bankais. I don't really find any of them impressive, because usually when you see the shikai, you have an idea of what the bankai is going to be like, sort of. I do like, however, Byakuya's bankai. It's called Senbon Sakura Kageyoshi. I like it just because it's basically just a bigger version of his shikai, and it looks cool. I really like his shikai too. 1,000 little blades that just happen to look like flowers. This time it's like even more blades, and it's basically the same attack except bigger. So I enjoy that simplicity, and that's why I would say that that's my favorite bankai so far. Number 8, favorite fight. Definitely should be the fake Karakura Town fight, just because there were so many twists in that fight. Like, we learned so many things too. We learned what Aizen was trying to do. We learn what he had done in order to get to that point with the Vice Arts, with the Hogyoku. We learned so many things, and at the same time there were so many twists. Moments where you thought, oh my god, Aizen just, they got him. Then he's like, nope, you don't have me. And then everything starts all over again. And there's several times that happens. The whole thing with Gin and Matsumoto, there's so much to that fight. It's really my favorite one. And one of the few fights that I've actually been able to get through, not necessarily because it was like, oh my god, everyone's so powerful, slash, cut, but because it was all about, you know, trying to outsmart Aizen, and I really love that. Number 9, favorite opening. Now, keep in mind that, like with the manga, the anime eventually, as they started to go into like fillers and fillers and fillers, I started getting bored with it, so I stopped watching eventually, and I never actually watched the ending. So I only really know the first few opening sequences and the first few ending sequences as well. So I don't know all of them, I haven't seen all of them, but I do have two that stand out to me. If we're talking about my favorite song that was used as an opening, that will probably be the Techno Life, because that song is just amazing. It's just an awesome song, okay? Now the animation for it wasn't the greatest, but I love the song. If we are talking about the favorite animation sequence for an opening, it's probably Rambo no Melody. I love that animation sequence so much that I actually downloaded it and have it on my iPod, and I rewatch it as much as I can because I think it's so gorgeous. It's so cinematic. The coloring is amazing. The effects that are used are amazing. I just adore that entire sequence. Now, the song is okay. I like it too. It's not my favorite Bleach song ever. It's not one of my favorite J-pop songs ever. Mainly for me, it's the animation. I could watch that thing over and over again on loop forever and love it even more every single time. It's just so gorgeous. I adore that opening sequence. Number 10, favorite ending. That's Hokiwashi all the way. Yay! I love that song. That song is fantastic. And then the ending was also so great because there were several different endings for that song. It wasn't just one animation sequence, it was there 13 of them, one for each squad of the Gotei 13. They gave you like little looks at the daily lives of each of the squads and each of the captains and each of the vice captains. And it was so adorable because we got to learn so much about them from just the ending sequence. 13, that's dedication, man. That's my favorite always. Oshiyata shiga hokiwashi ni nareta naraba. I can't sing that song, it's difficult for me to get to those high notes, but whatever, I'm gonna try. Number 11, most epic moment. And that is, as I hinted at before, most definitely going to be in the battle of Fake Karakura Town. I specifically really liked when Shiro-chan and Hirako managed to catch Aizen by surprise, with Hirako using his shikai to confuse him, and then all of a sudden Shiro-chan comes up and stabs him right through. I really like that. Aizen's face in that panel is going to be forever etched into my mind, honestly. But at the same time, I really like it because, nope, guess what? That's not what's really going on. Aizen can manipulate minds too, and he's got you fooled, dude! Eventually, it turns out that Hitsugaya just stabbed freaking Momo, and my heart is breaking, and I don't know what's going on anymore, and it's just a freaking amazing, just entire sequence, as far as I'm concerned. Number 12, favorite visor. That would probably be Hirako, just because he's the only one I regularly remember. I know I'm a horrible person, I'm sorry, I'm just really bad with names. When characters don't interest me, I just forget about them. So most of the visors I don't really care for. I like Hirako. Lisa was kind of cool too. Just putting that out there. I remember Lisa. She was okay. Number 13, a scene that made you happy. I don't really know. There's a lot of Bleach that made me happy, but it's been so long. If you ask me right now, I just tend to associate Bleach with like a lot of pain and suffering and angst and drama and action and let's do it and determination and a lot of that, not so much of fun. But I know there are plenty of scenes that have made me happy in Bleach. Honestly, anytime Ishida and Orihime are in the same scene together, I love. It makes me smile. Even if they're just standing next to each other, I smile. Except, of course, for the ones that stab me through the heart. Thank you, Kubo. But mostly, whenever there's any kind of interaction between the two of them, I'm happy. Number 14, a scene that made you sad. The whole thing with Gin and Rangiku, you gotta feel for them, man. They've been together for such a long time, come to depend on each other so much. Then Gin turns against the whole Soul Society and you're freaking tears already. It's like, how could he do that to her? And then it turns out that no, he had his own agenda for her. Basically, he was doing everything that he was doing for her, and then he goes and dies, sobbing, curled into a ball. What the hell, Gin? How? Just what? It's just so sad. It's so sad. Not to mention, I'm still waiting for Gin to come back, Kubo. Like, you brought back everyone. Every single person has come back, Except Gabe. Please don't let him come back. Please, I need them to be happy. Can they just be happy? Number 15, favorite Sanpakuto spirit. Chiro-chan's Hyoremaru. Let's face it, it's a fucking ice dragon. How much cooler do you think it could possibly get? I love Hyoremaru, he's amazing, and it's so great because Chiro-chan is so tiny, but then when he gets like a giant ice dragon on his back, you're like, okay, this dude is badass. How can you not love Hyoremaru? It's such a great spirit to have, come on. Number 16, favorite fan couple. I'm assuming it just means favorite ship. My OTP in Bleach is Ishida and Orihime. I love them to death. I don't know if they'll be canon. I don't care if they'll be canon. They are the OTP of my heart. I don't care what Kubo goes or what he does with them. Every time they get a moment, my heart sings. So I don't even freaking care if she ends up with Ichigo. That's great. I have no problems with Ichigo. I want the best for Orihime, so if she ends up with Ichigo, fine by me. I am hoping that she ends up with Ishida just because they've been my OTP from the beginning. I think they have a great connection there. They're both like dorks, even though Ishida kind of likes to pretend that he's cool. But they're both massive dorks, and they're both very caring in their own way. But whereas Orihime is like, yay, love and rainbows and friendship and everything great and helping people and whatever, Ishida's very reserved. He doesn't tell people how he feels. He's very serious and academically minded, whereas Orihime is kind of more of a ditz, but they're such opposites that I just kind of love them together. I do hope that it happens for them. I think it's fairly obvious at this point that Ishida has a crush on her. She doesn't reciprocate as far as we know because there's the whole Ichigo thing, but I'm rooting for them. That's all I can say. I do have other ships though. I ship Rukia with either Ichigo or Renji. Either of them I will totally be okay with, and I think they're both great guys, so I don't mind it. Obviously Gin and Matsumoto. Sometimes I get bitten by the Hitsugaya Hinamori bug, but then half the time I'm kind of pissed at her because she doesn't notice how much he cares about her. Half the time I'm like, yes, please get together, and half the time I'm like, nope, stay apart. I don't want you anywhere near each other anymore because you just hurt each other. I don't even know, I'm conflicted when it comes to them, but I guess you count them. But definitely my OTP forever and ever, and regardless of what happens in canon, is going to be Ishida and Orihime because they are my babies. I love them to death. 17, most pointless episode. Now, like I said, I haven't watched the entire anime. There's a lot of it that I just didn't bother watching, but I don't really have a specific episode from out of those that I watched that I hated. I wasn't as interested when there was stuff about Kon. I don't really care about Kon, I'm sorry. I know people think he's one of the Nakama and he has to be there. I don't care about Kon. I really don't. And when episodes focused on him, it was sort of like very blah to me. I didn't care. Number 18. A character you feel you're most like. Here's the thing. I have no freaking clue. Okay? I don't know. So I did like several different quizzes. Which Bleach character are you quiz and whatever. I did several of them. I got Ichigo 3 times. I got Ishida 2 times. I got Hinamori. I got Rukia. I got Orihime. Like, why? Because of the red hair? Is that it? And Urahara. And I don't even know. I'm not even going to bother. I don't know that I actually identify with any of them that hard. If I had to choose, it would probably be something like maybe Rukia, I guess. Sort of, maybe a little bit of Urahara, but I don't know. I'm definitely not like Ishida, not like Ichigo, not like Orihime. I can tell you who I'm not like, but it's very difficult for me to actually choose one character that I identify with in this show because I just think they're all so different and they all have their little pluses and minuses, and they're also different that several different characters have just aspects to them that share with me, but then they also have several aspects that they don't share with me, so it's very difficult. I don't know, you guys tell me, who do I remind you of? Tell me in a comment. If you watch Bleach or read the manga, tell me, who do I remind you of? I'll probably get a lot of Orihime, just saying. Number 19, a character you wish you were more like. That would have to be Okitake, because he is so nice. This guy, he's like the picture of niceness. I love him to death. He's so great. He's a great captain. He's so supportive of the people in his squad, and he's just generally nice to everybody. Even when he's dealing with his own sickness, it tugs at my heart. He's so great. I would love to be more like him. I aspire to be like him. When I grow up, I want to be like Okitake. Number 20, favorite Arrancar. I don't know, I really loved Stark for no reason at all. He didn't really do all that much in the grand scheme of things. I know people are really into Urquiorra. I didn't care for him, honestly. Just because he was emo or whatever. I didn't care for Urquiorra. Grimjow has his moments. At least he's funny, and now he's fighting for the right side, so I can take Grimjow. Mostly it was Stark. I really like Stark for no reason at all. Don't ask me, sometimes I just like characters for no reason. That's it. Number 21. Least favorite Arrancar. That's gotta be the freaking goddamn butterfly, aka Sayel. I can't stand him. You guys, I can't stand him and his stupid Elton John glasses and his ridiculous butterfly wings and his disgustingness. He was so disgusting, you guys. I can't stand him. Neutra was pretty disgusting as well. Also, baby Nell was kind of annoying. I like Nell in general, but just when she was tiny, she could get really annoying really quickly. Number 22, favorite released form. I'm not entirely sure what they mean by released form. There's several things in Bleach that could be taken as a released form. I'm just gonna go with the Zanpakutos again, but I'm gonna take it to be the physical manifestation of the Zanpakuto in the Unknown Tales arc, because I like them. I like that idea. So my favorite out of all of them was, well, first of all, Hyorimaru, because duh, again, cool giant ice dragon suddenly becomes human, and he is the coolest human ever written into manga. Pun totally intended, by the way. Hyorimaru was awesome. But I also really like Katsushimi, which is Chuhei's Zanpakuto, of course. I really liked him just because he was such a freaking psycho. He loved killing, he was bloodthirsty, and I loved every bit of Katsushimi. And just the contrast to Shuhei, who's following orders and really quiet and not necessarily really intense, and he's just this quiet guy, likes to get along with people, goes drinks with his friends or whatever it is that they do. And he's so nice and he doesn't want to kill anyone necessarily, but then his sword is freaking insane. I just thought it was really great. Just the contrast. Contrast was really awesome. And I like characters that are freaking batshit psycho just because they can be. Katsushimi did that for me. He was the requisite amount of psycho for this whole Zanpakuto Tales arc. I really enjoyed it. Number 23, a character you're in love with. I've already said this. Chino-chan! I love him. I love him to death. I'm so glad, and this is a spoiler again.
Danger, Will Robinson! Danger! No, Will Robinson! Danger!
But I'm so glad that he's grown up now and my crush on him is not horribly creepy, because seriously, I have loved him forever, and the only deterrent was that he was a child. I was like, can you just like grow up? Now Kubo has made my dream come true, and Chino-chan is grown up and hotter than ever. I freaking love him, okay? He's so hot. Oh my god. So great too. He's so cool. I just adore him. Number 24, funniest scene. I'm gonna just claim not available in this one just because it's one of those things again. Nowadays I tend to associate Bleach with like suffering and grief and action and just angst and drama and stuff like that, and not necessarily funny stuff. So I know at the beginning there were a few funny scenes that made me laugh. I don't remember many of them right now, so sorry, no answer for this one. Number 25, favorite line slash quote. I have a few of those, honestly. Bleach happens to be quite deep when Kubo sets his mind up to it. So, I have a few of those. The first one is a quote by Ukitake to Rukia about Kaien. Listen to me, remember this well. There are two kinds of fight. We must always know the difference. A fight to defend life, and a fight to defend pride. I thought this was a really deep quote because, yes, you fight for different things, and sometimes you're not necessarily fighting to defend yourself, you're fighting to defend an ideal that you have, or just your own pride, and that's not a bad thing. It's not a bad thing to fight for your pride as long as you keep in mind what's more important to you. And sometimes people might be alive, but if they don't feel pride of their own existence, then they might as well not be living. I kind of understand what he meant to say in this one, and I really like it. The second quote that I love is from Shuhei, something that Tosen, his captain, actually taught him a long time ago. Those who do not fear the sword they wield have no right to wield the sword at all. And I don't mean by this just the fact that I would probably cut off my own fingers if I ever actually had to hold a sword in my hand. It reminds me of Kenshin from Rurouni Kenshin a little bit. He always kept saying, swords are a weapon to kill. That's what they are. That's what they're created for. But at the same time, you have to know what a sword is capable of doing if you want to use it for good. That's sort of what Shuhei's line is telling me here, is that you have to know what you can do with a sword, or else you're really not worth it to use it. You're not worthy of that sword. It's a very noble weapon. It's a very direct weapon. It's in the Japanese especially, put so much mythos into their swords. Samurais, there was a whole class of people that were so honorable, and they lived and died by the sword and to make their craft with the sword better. And I really do think that it's important for fighters, or it would be important in this context for fighters, to know what a sword is, what it can do, and to be afraid of what it can do, because that's the only way that you can hold yourself back and do the right thing, instead of killing people indiscriminately, just using the sword in order to make things right. But the only way that you can do that is if you know what using the sword for wrong would be. So I think it's very interesting. It speaks a lot about the darkest aspects of human psyche. So I really enjoyed that one. And the third one, a phrase by Kira when he's fighting an enemy, he says, "War is not heroic. War is not exhilarating. War is full of despair. It is dark. It is dreadful. It is a thing of sorrow and gloom. That's why people fear war. That is why people choose to avoid it." It's really true. I mean, who would have thought that Kira would come up with this, of all people? It's kind of funny. Sometimes the things that he says are very inspirational. And I like this because it is a reflection of war. You have Bleach, which is a shonen manga, meaning it has a lot of action, it has a lot of fights, and we always really want to see our characters fighting and being cool and trying to one-up each other and blah blah blah. It's a constant reminder through this quote that fighting is not a good thing. It's really not. Fighting makes people suffer. Fighting gives people pain. And it's not something that we should do as a sport. It's not something that should make us want to cheer and yay, you're so cool because you killed how many people. It's not like that. You fight because you have to, not because you want to. And it's a stark contrast to someone like Kenpachi, for example, who loves to fight and lives to fight. It's a reminder that if you're not fighting for the right thing, then it's better to not fight at all. Number 26, a character you would love to cosplay. I don't know. I mean, with my hair, I figure it would probably be like Orihime or something. I guess she would be the easiest. It would be her regular clothes though, not the ridiculous, blatantly objectifying fighting outfits that Kubo loves to put her in, which honestly, it pisses me off every time he does that. I wouldn't cosplay any of her fighting outfits, but just her regular clothes, I think it's fine. Like, maybe her school uniform would be interesting? I don't know. 27. Favorite minor character. I have many! I mean, there's so many characters in this freaking series. Kubo says that whenever he feels himself getting blocked or not knowing what to write, he just starts making up characters. Well, whenever I get bored, I start forgetting characters, so I guess we're even in that sense. But I do have a few minor characters that are my favorites. For example, Ugetake, I love. He is fantastic. I adore him to death. I've already gone over this. He's the nicest person ever, and I love him, and I want to be like him when I grow up. And also Shuhei, whom I've mentioned several times already through the course of this video. I like him. I think he's a sweet guy who has his own issues. He's been betrayed. He's dealing with a sword that wants to kill everybody. He's a cool guy. I wish he could get more of a spotlight every now and then, because he doesn't get nearly enough. Number 28. A character that you wish never had to die. There's only one answer for that. Ugetake! Why? Why would you do that to me, Kubo? I love him so much, and you take him away from me. You kill him because you want him to be the right hand of the king, or however it is. You haven't even explained that yet, but then I have to assume that Ugetake is dead, and it's so not fair. As far as I'm concerned, he's not dead. He's coming back. I'm telling you guys, he's gonna come back. That's all I'm saying. There's no way he's dead. 29. Favorite episode ever. Probably the end of the Soul Society arc. Maybe not the single last episode of the arc, but probably like the last three or so. Those were my favorites just because of the Aizen twist and the way everything wrapped up. I thought it was really, really well done. Yeah, if I have to choose, it would probably be one of those. And then lastly, but not least, number 30. Why do you love Bleach? I love Bleach because the characters are amazing. For a dude that seems to create so many characters, so many of them don't even matter in the grand scheme of things, but those that do matter are fantastic. I love all the Shinigami, I love the Nakama, I love Ichigo and his family, I love the Quincy, at least the Ishida family. I love all of them, they're so great, and he makes such great, diverse, different characters. They can relate to each other, but not one of them is exactly the same. Not one of them is bland either, like all of them have this little quirks and details and aspects to them that make them different and make them stand out and make them interesting. They all have such colorful backstories, I love it. Speaking of backstories, another thing that blows me away from Bleach is that all of a sudden we're in the last arc and you look back at the past and it's like all the overarching storylines are connected. It just blows my mind as someone who wants to be a writer. It blows my mind how Kubo was able to do that and make it seem organic. Everything is connected, really, everything is. And just the idea that he's been planning this for like a decade, over a decade, is like mind-blowing to me. Kubo is a great writer. He might take like large detours over really boring fights that make me lose interest, but eventually he pulls me back in with a nice twist. He's an incredible writer. And yep, that's it for the 30-day challenge. I'm gonna start wrapping it up. As usual, I have no real idea of what I'm gonna do next week. But I'm open to suggestions, so you guys, if you think there's any topics that you would like me to talk about, any geeky topics such as TV, books, movies, anything that is happening in geek culture right now that you want me to talk about, leave it in a comment, and if it's something that I'm knowledgeable about, I'll definitely add it to my list of videos to make. In the meantime, you can find me on social media. I am on Twitter and Instagram at Girls Are Weird with underscores between the words, and I'm also on Tumblr at Girls Are Weird with hyphens between the words. You can find Freakin' Narnia on Facebook at facebook.com/FreakinNarnia, so be sure to visit, like, and subscribe if you're around. I also have another YouTube channel called Bookending, that's bookend.i.ng, where I read the endings of books with you guys, discuss them, and just generally fangirl all about them. If you're into that, be sure to check it out over here. As usual, remember to visit my website at FreakingNarnia.com. All my videos are up there, so if you want to catch up or something, just be sure to check that out. If you like this video, give me a thumbs up. If you like my stuff, please subscribe. I post videos every Friday. Maybe you'll find something you like in the near future, so be sure to subscribe. I know what I'm gonna do with my life now that I've finished with 40 chapters of Bleach. Maybe I will go and catch up on like 25 chapters of Attack on Titan that I also have pending. I'm not sure yet, but I'm going to go my way, and I will see you guys next Friday with another talk from all the way in freaking Narnia. Bye guys. I swear to God, I know how many fingers is in 7. Number 20. Sorry guys, I swear I can count. No, I said that backwards. Videos that are, I can't talk today. 25 chapters of Attack on Bleach or whatever.